part of Happy Tuesday. This is another Tuesday trivia where I feature and we learn about another wonderful artist working in film, television, and or theater today. Behind me are six Dalmatian dogs. Five. Yeah. There are six Dalmatian dogs here, and that is because in 1996, our featured artist starred in a live-action version of 101 Dalmatians. So before we get to that and to our featured artist today, we are going to move and groove to the music from 1982, the film The Big Chill, which our incredible artist was also a part of that acting ensemble. You may guess who she is, that's okay, but I definitely will reveal her identity after we do the moving and grouping. All right? Love that. Love Motown. Anytime I can write out to a Motown song, move it and groove it to a Motown song, I'm very happy. That was a single song from the Four Tops. But you know, I love classic Motown. The same old song was also on the soundtrack of the movie The Big Chill, which starred, in addition to Jeff Goldblum and Mary Kay Place and Kevin Kline and Joe Beth Williams, it also starred, and Kevin Costner had a very small role in that. He was the guy in the coffin. But who also was in it is a featured artist today, the amazing Glenn Close. That's right, guys. Today, our featured artist is Glenn Close, a multi-award-winning, award-nominated artist, Glenn Close. She was born in Greenwich, Connecticut, on March 19th, 1947. She is still one of the busiest working actors today. Her career spans over 40 years. And she has won 2 SAG Awards, 3 Golden Globe Awards, 2 Emmy Awards, 3 Tony Awards, including one for Sunset Boulevard, 1995, and she holds the record for having the most acting nominations for an Academy Award without ever winning one. So she's been nominated so far for 8 Academy Awards, and both Best Actress and Best Supporting Actress. She's been nominated for 8, but to this date, she has yet to win one. But I hope she will win here because she is absolutely incredible. And funny. And what I also love about her is she does a lot, she's done a lot of theater. I love that. She's produced, she's worked very and often made medium film, television, theater, on stage. In 2019, she was inducted into the American Theater Hall of Fame, and I'm pretty sure she had many more awards and honors in her future. What we're gonna look at today is from a video called Glenn Close in Her Own Words, and she's going to break down some of her iconic roles and how she prepared for them. And I really love that. I really want to share. I love the fun things that I want to share with you. But I hope you enjoy this, and then we'll talk about it and go to our bonus round after we watch the clip.
All we want as actors is to have great roles. I have not had a career where all the great parts have come onto my desk. I just have not had the luxury of just sitting around and having people pour great scripts my way. I think of my career as challenging and working at it, making things happen. I'm Glenn Close, and this is the timeline of my career.
Is it all right?
It's not an it. It's a she, and she's all right.
I was starring in Barnum on Broadway, and George Roy Hill and Marion Dougherty, who really, she pioneered the role of casting director. And George said later that she knew what he wanted more than he did. They sat and watched me in Barnum, and I was asked to come in and audition for Jenny Fields.
But he can't feel life, so he takes off the gloves and he dies, but he finally feels life as he's flying into the arms of death.
If that's what it means, I like it.
And the memo that went out to all the agents was a young Katharine Hepburn. So I gave probably the worst audition of my life. I was not good at auditioning, but George told me later that it was probably the worst audition he'd ever seen because I was kind of trying to talk like Katharine Hepburn. But somehow I got the role of Jenny Fields. When I got my first Oscar nomination, it was totally out of my even realm of possibility. I was in the cellar of Tidal Home where we were shooting The Big Chill. And I heard that I'd gotten nominated, and it was like, what? It just was something I'd never dreamed of. I've never even thought of.
She's got the hiccups.
You should be here. I feel like we should have had a chair for Alex. Of course you don't have enough food.
I was asked to do a reading by Larry Kasdan. I remember going up to Larry saying, I bet you want me to play Sarah Cooper, because I wanted to play the part that Mary Kay Place ended up playing. I thought that was a much kind of juicier part. The entire cast got together on the lot of Columbia. I think it was a month before we went down to Atlanta, where we shot the epilogue, which does not appear in the movie. And we lived in these, we each had apartments out Inland Waterway or, you know, somewhere down in South Carolina. I'm an introvert, and I would, you know, I was reading my book in my apartment, and Mary Kay knocked on the door and said, Kevin and Jeff Goldblum and Jo Beth and I, we're all gonna meet and have dinner and play games. And I said, oh I'm sorry, I can't cry. And she literally, physically pulled me up, pulled me in, and that was the beginning of our hardcore group that ate dinner together, danced, played Trivial Pursuit, played jokes on each other, dressed up for Halloween. You know, that was the beginning of that.
I love you all so much. I know that sounds gross, doesn't it?
The life we learn with, and the life we live with after that. With or without the records.
The Natural came my way because of Robert Redford. I was cast in a Merchant Ivory film, and it was my first real leading role part. Robert Redford, I met him at his office in New York, and he said, I want you in this movie, and we could work it out, that you could do both. Well, it didn't work out that we did both, and the other production got fed up, and I lost that role, but I ended up playing Iris, which I'm very happy for, because I love that movie, and I loved working with Bob Redford, and that started a lifelong friendship.
No choice, did I? I'm a woman. Women are obliged to be far more skillful than men. You can ruin our reputation and our life with a few well-chosen words.
I remember hearing that nobody's going to go watch a costume drama. We proved them wrong. That was fun. I had just given birth to Annie 7 weeks before I flew over to France. So I still had my mommy body that had to be absolutely crammed into a corset. And at the end of the day, I had these welts on my waist where the two kind of came together and rubbed. So, and that's why I have those wonderfully full bosom, because I had just weaned her. At first I thought, oh, maybe I could still nurse her during the filming, but to get out of those costumes and nurse and get back into the costumes would have been at least an hour and a half. James Acheson designed those magnificent costumes in Dangerous Liaisons. Stephen Frears, fantastic director. He did come closer and closer in on faces as the movie evolved, which to poor James Acheson would be pulling his hair because he wanted his costumes to show a lot. And I remember there's a scene of me sitting at my dressing table and he said, show the shoe. And I'm sitting in kind of a weird position and you can see the shoe on my foot.
So of course I had to invent not only myself.
Have you ever engaged in immoral conduct?
What do you mean by immoral?
As defined by the Department of Defense, alcohol abuse, drug abuse, homosexuality, adultery, sexual acts with a minor.
I'm a lesbian.
Yeah, I'm always seduced by a story. It also was the first time, well, no, the second time actually, when I said, I wonder if this is gonna affect my career, whether people will have negative reactions if I play a lesbian. Whenever I've confronted with that question, my next question to myself is, well, what's the alternative? Not to do it because you're afraid? No.
Why did you disclose your sexual orientation to the DIS agent?
Because he asked, and it was the truth, and I was being honest.
Doing that movie at a time when it was Don't Ask, Don't Tell, both Greta Kammermeier and myself, we got these letters from women who tell you what it meant to see a hero that's like me. It had a profound effect on the LGBTQ world. And I'm very proud of that effect. And when Obama did away with the Don't Ask, Don't Tell, Greta was right there behind his desk.
Anita, darling.
Good morning, Cruella.
Well, I had grown up with a great Disney animated features, Snow White, Cinderella, Bambi. I was very aware of the value of witches in fairy tales. As a young child, I loved fairy tales, and to be asked to be a Disney witch, which is what Cruella is, was thrilling to me. So I had a wonderful vocal coach for Cruella, and I loved the Joanna Lumley's accent in Absolutely Fabulous, and my coach, Joan Washington, knows her, and she had this very clipped way of talking. Also, I emulated Trevor Nunn, who had directed me in Sunset Boulevard, and he has this way of, he makes things, take it or leave it, you know, and he doesn't talk like that all the time or else he'd kill me, but just really strong consonants and clipped very much in power.
Alonzo? Did you ask Anita if she'd like something to drink?
College kids know me as Cruella because my costume collection is at Indiana University, which is fantastic. I was there at one point and we had a showing of it was Fatal Attraction, actually, but it's the first time these kids had seen that movie, and they were, you know, just as stunned as people have been all along. But they do know me as Cruella, and the younger ones know me as Nova Prime in the Guardians of the Galaxy. So my entire career is just those two parts.
What a charming dog.
Thank you. Why don't you just leave the Roosevelt room the way the Roosevelts wanted it?
Because Eleanor Roosevelt was too fond of chimps.
God, I loved doing Mars Attacks. It was so much fun to be in the room with all those other incredible actors. Jack Nicholson for my husband. I had a Pat Nixon wig. That was pretty funny. And to be killed by the Nancy Reagan chandelier. I mean, the whole thing was just delicious. But we had a perfect replica of the Oval Office. And whenever Jack Nicholson would come on stage, they'd play dun, 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 dun. So there's a great sense of fun, but also a great sense of professionalism.
Madam Vice President, this way, we'll avoid the press.
Is the president secure?
Not yet. The recovery team will have him very soon.
One thing I remember was they had a scene around that table where she broke down crying. And I said, I will not do that. I don't think that would happen. Not my vice president. My vice president would not break down into tears. She would step up to the challenge. So they changed it. I love playing that part. Again, surrounded by a great ensemble of actors. I think I was kind of a late casting because I remember my hair was actually one of my wigs that I'd used in something else, and it was redone by my brilliant wig maker / hairdresser at the time, Marcel Corneville, who just did me in Hillbilly Elegy. One of the great masters of the craft of wig making and all of Cruella's hairstyles, for example. He should have won an Oscar for that.
I think directors are just showing off when they try to film a sex scene. I don't think they're really trying to show us sex. I think they're just trying to show us they're not afraid to show us sex. I mean, it's like they're all thumbing their noses at their mothers.
Well, I had known Christopher Reeve since he and Robin, they were best friends. And when we were shooting my first movie, Garp, Christopher would fly in his little plane, because he was a pilot, pick up Robin. They were bad boys at the time. And they would fly off somewhere for the weekend. They'd fly back, he'd kind of dump Robin out. I loved him. He would have been one of our top directors had he lived. He was astounding. It was a difficult piece. It was quite a literary piece. And he made it human. He made it actable. You know, the dialogue was wonderful. And to see him behind that monitor, in that chair, doing such wonderful work, I'm blessed that I experienced that.
You know, I speak a little French, Mr. Coupe. And just because that little outburst wasn't in English doesn't mean it's not going to be on the record.
What did he say? Tell me what did you say?
He called me a manipulative bitch. You get that?
I had done one season on The Shield. And it actually was John Landgraf who convinced me, because he was all about the writing and the artists. He still is that way. I mean, he's remarkable. So I did The Shield, and that kind of was my first, you know, real toe in the water with series. So I said, basically, at the end, if you ever, you know, have an idea for me, come to me, as long as it's in New York, because that's where my life was at the time. They came back and had one of the most brilliant pieces of writing I've ever read, which was the first pilot. I remember I gave it to my great friend Anne Roth, who has designed costumes for me my whole career, and she also is a very smart woman with a great sense of story and everything, and I asked her to read it, and she came back and said, you would be crazy not to do this. I did it, and I signed my life away, you know, for a possible 6 years, ended up doing it for 5. The writers never, ever, ever let me down. The key to that character kind of came to me in a scene. It was a scene with Rose, and I realized that her power came with keeping people off balance. The only time that she ever showed her true feelings was in private. Never would she let her power go by being emotional, unless it was calculated.
Please, May we go off the record?
Certainly.
He is slaughtering children. Families.
That is your business. Now I have other matters to attend to.
Prick.
I've always wanted to be in a superhero movie, and I'd love to be in another one. I just love that whole thing. It's like going back to when I was, 6 years old, because half of it you have to act in your imagination. In the set, they had this big round thing that had this, you could see the hologram of the battle, but of course it wasn't there. And they have some guy with a pole with a tennis ball on it that's like a spaceship. And I remember standing around there and thinking, yeah, I can do this. I used to do it when I was little. I can imagine that there's a war going on in front of me 3 feet away. I love that stuff. Anybody out there?
What's your name?
Albert.
Your real name?
Albert.
It took me 14 years to get that film shot. I got the rights to the material and, then I'd get a job, then I'd come back, then I had to at one point change directors. And when we finally ended up doing it, it was with the right people, the right cast. It was just the most wonderful experience because I've always been very attracted to characters who don't have any self-pity. And yet they don't know that their dream is impossible, but we do. And it makes them incredibly compelling. I loved Albert for her innocent belief. I played her as a woman who didn't know what she was. She had never been touched with love. She had never had a partner of any kind. She was existing in disguise in order to survive. It's a story of someone who had to become invisible in order to survive. And I think there are so many people in the world who have had to face that.
I don't want it. It's yours. It's all yours. I don't want it.
We came to a point where I was told that Bjorn Runge was going to come to New York and we were going to have breakfast together. And it was up to me whether he would be the director. During the course of that meal, I got a sense that he would be a wonderful man to work with. I had nothing to go on except he's done theater, he's written, he's done movies. I said, I think let's do this movie together. And he's one of the best directors I ever worked with because he trusted the actor's face. He trusted the close-up. He used the close-up very judiciously to keep the audience emotionally connected to my character. If a director sets up a feeling of trust, then you're absolutely free, to do your best work. And we had that atmosphere of trust. And with Jonathan, the first scene we shot was the scene in bed. So, oh, hello, I'm Glenn, I'm Jonathan, okay, let's jump into bed.
Well, why can't we let her clean her own mess up for once?
Because family's the only thing that means a goddamn.
I read the book basically when it came out and I loved it. And then I think it was a couple of years later, I heard that Ron had gotten the rights and was developing a script. I've always been very proactive about things. I wrote him a note. I wrote him a letter. We had done the paper, a number of years ago. And I just wrote him. I said, whenever you are casting, I hope you will think of me, thinking no one will ever cast me as Mamaw. And lo and behold, he offered it to me. We had time as a company to get together, to go to Middletown, Ohio, to meet the members of the family, of JD's family who were there, who had amazing courage to let these strangers come in, knowing that they were gonna portray themselves and members of their family. That we, each of us as individuals, got time to talk to each member of the family. And we each had our own kind of questions to ask. And my questions were, how did she sit? How did she walk? What did she do with her hands? How did she hold her cigarette? What did her voice sound like? So you can do justice to who they were. There's nothing better than having a wonderful story and having a company that's like this great chemical creature, that everybody's contribution counts. And Ron Howard puts together those kinds of teams where you're free to do your best work because everyone is doing their best work. What I've learned, you own your choices. You don't know at the moment why you are particularly attracted to that story, but you are. And you think it's good because you think it's good. not because somebody tells you that you're going to make a lot of money or you're going to get an award. You think it's good. You have to stay subjective to your own spirit, you know. I've tried to do that. And at this point, you know, if I wasn't owning my career, I might as well do something else.
All right, guys, the part is amazing. I enjoyed that. And I hope you, I'm hoping you're getting from these, when I show you these, is that the dedication and work it takes to be an actor, you know, it's not just something you get up and do. She's worked so hard and she put so much work and detail into preparing for each role, and I really hope you guys get that. So, let's go to a vote. Okay, bonus question number one. How many times has the Glenn Close been nominated for an Oscar? She's never won, but how many times has she been nominated? That's bonus question number one. How many times has the Glenn Close been nominated for an Oscar? That's bonus question number one. Bonus question number two. Name a film like Glenn Close was in. Okay, bonus question number two, name a film that Glenn Close was in. Okay, I reveal. Bonus question number one, how many times had Glenn Close been nominated for an Oscar? Bonus question number two, name a film that Glenn Close was in. Okay? Good job, Jack. Good job. All right, guys, we're going to end it the very beginning. Another song from that great film, The Big Chill, which honestly, guys, is also one of my favorite movie soundtracks. Let's move it and groove it, and I'll see you tomorrow. Tomorrow will be at Encore Motivational Wednesday. Send Tuesday Trivia Answers to DEJClass@gmail.com or set their call 323-364-2478.